Cleveland Airport is closed and will reopen on July.
The runway may be closed to aircraft, but the champ cars are taking off. The top three qualifiers have landed, ready to battle. Fastest flight takes the pole. The edge of Lake Erie in downtown Cleveland, the Burt Lakefront Airport and the CART FedEx Championship Series is ready to qualify for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. Now, we've got the cars on the track now in qualifying. We've had a lot of cars on the track, and at the same time, we've also had quite a few cars off of the track, Parker Johnstone.
Check out how bumpy this airport circuit is. It's the widest circuit that they come to all year long. Let's the drivers hang it out. There's very little to hit. Guys are trying exceptionally hard. We've had car after car spinning, and usually with nothing more than going off the grass, maybe a torn wing end plate. Sometimes the bottom of the under tray gets damaged, but if you really work hard at it, like Luis Garcia Jr., you can find some concrete.
And even though a lot of those look like tiny little offs, they can be very expensive. You consider the sophistication of the underwing on these cars. Max Pappas currently not doing nearly what he would like. Qualified currently for inside the eighth row, and there you get a good idea of how bumpy it can be on this course. Here is provisional qualifying at this moment with Dario Franchitti setting up at the top at 130 miles an hour.
We may be about to see the most exciting qualification period of the season. If yesterday's first round of qualifying is any kind of prediction, they were changing constantly, and this course is so rough and so bumpy. Of the 25 cars that are here in this morning practice, 12 of them were off course. They're trying hard.
As you said, it is wide, it is bumpy, and significantly, there's very little to hit. The guys are driving extremely hard, and we've come into the point of the season where people are talking about championship, they're talking about contract negotiations for next year. The final moments of the final qualifying session, I think every time a car passes the start-finish line, we'll see a new provisional pole sitter. It should be very exciting.
Let's go down to the pits right now, and Gary Gerrell.
Paul, I don't think there's any doubt. Everybody who comes to Cleveland loves to run at this place. It's wide open. It is rough. You've got a handful. But how about Cristiano D'Amata making a bid? This little guy weighs 125 pounds. He's wheeling a near 1,600-pound race car around here through the bumps, and he was fast in the practice this morning. Now, he wants to step up. He wants to challenge Dario Franchitti. But as Parker suggested, everybody is in that same mode as we look ahead to this qualifying session. And Franchitti may have put it best yesterday when he said when he got out of the race car, I think the guy who gets the last lap tomorrow, meaning today in the final qualifying session, will be the fastest. It's going to be a dandy. We've got breaking news further up pit road. Here's Jan Bikas.
Yeah, we do, Gary. And, of course, the second fastest qualifier yesterday was Michael Andretti. And when they rolled the Newman-Haas cars off the trailer, they had something different. They put a spacer in front of the nose and moved the front wings forward because they'd extended the wheelbase. Now, the Ganassi team has won here the last 3 years. They were struggling. Well, look what happens today. Juan Montoya rolls his car out. Here's the spacer that moves the nose and the wings, what, 4 or 5 inches farther forward. Then you can change the suspension and move the wheels forward. It changes the wheelbase. When you do that, it changes the weight distribution, puts more weight on the back, helps the traction. So a bit of monkey see, monkey do that are hoping they'll get them back up to the front.
Amazing they can do that at the last minute. Here is the way they lay out this airport.
And the key to qualifying to get the most out of this 2.1 mile circuit is this back section in the carousel, turns 6, 7, and 8. It's very rough. They're pulling about 3 G's, 140 miles an hour. Then they have to get through this very quick 140 mile an hour chicane. If they can get both of those corners right, then they've got to get on the brakes very hard and very late coming into turn one. There are very little visual references here at Cleveland, making it difficult for the drivers to place the car precisely lap after lap.
Here is Christian Fittipaldi. He is the second quick right now of this group. Max Pappas just laid down the quickest lap, good enough for 12th quick. And Christian Fittipaldi jumped up substantially, and he is now 13th fastest overall. Remember, this is the first of the two groups. Theoretically, the slower of the two groups. But especially with the times they've been laying down here, Parker, that is such a narrow margin. We were looking at 16 within 1 second yesterday.
As we watch Christian Fittipaldi and just in front of him, Mark Blundell, both of these teams, the PacWest team and the Newman-Haas team, they've just come into the pits now, have worked very hard at getting the cars to ride over the bumps, almost to the sacrifice of getting the traction down and high-speed handling. Mark Blundell and his teammate Mauricio Guzelman ran very strong this morning. Mauricio was fourth, Mark Blundell ninth, one of the few times we've seen both cars of the PacWest group in the top 10 this season.
And Oriel Servia, while we're watching Blundell, who improved his position to 17th on the last lap, Oriel Servia just jumped into the top 10, ninth quick at 130.14 miles an hour.
I talked to Oriel after this morning's session. He was very confident in how he and his engineer John Dick were getting this car prepared for this afternoon. Oriel was a little concerned going out in this first group that the track might get better for the second group, but still, being new here to Champ Car Racing at this circuit, now he's run here before in Indy Lights, he thought he had a good chance to overall get his car into the top 10.
And of course, he is the teammate to Cristiano D'Amato. We talked about, Gary talked about in the open, so Oriel Servia certainly will benefit somewhat of the information that D'Amato acquired during this morning session where he, in fact, did so well.
And in fact, when I walked into the trailer, what Oriel was looking at was the speed chart comparison between he and Cristiano D'Amato. They were just about evenly matched everywhere except back in that carousel section, turn 6, 7, and 8, where Cristiano was a good 10 miles an hour faster all the way through the corner. So Oriel knows what he has to do to get this car and himself up to speed.
Now he jumps up to 130.145 miles an hour. He was at 128 yesterday, 129 this morning, so he's steadily moving up. Gary Gerald?
Paul Parker was talking about the number of drivers and teams that have had problems over the course of the weekend. Bob Sterling and our research staff here have been helping us out. They've been going through all the notes of all the practice sessions from yesterday and today. It now turns out, coming into this session, 43 incidents where cars have been off course. 19 of the 25 drivers in this field have had some kind of an adventure or another. And where's been the biggest trouble spot? Turn four. Nine times somebody's gotten out of shape and had either a close call or gotten into a tire barrier in that vicinity. That is an amazing stat when you consider there was a practice session, one qualifying session yesterday, a practice session this morning, and we've had 43 incidents so far.
So the quickest of this group thus far is Oriel Servia, who sits ninth quick overall. He has broken into that top 10, the only one to do so from first group qualifying. When second group comes out, of course. Sunday, plenty of motorsports coverage. Car today, the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. You'll see that on ABC Sports. Then the wrap-up on RPM tonight for more. Log on to ESPN.com, part of Go Network, go.com. Brian Herta, as he crossed the line just seconds ago, took the provisional pole position, 131.129 miles an hour, a massive jump.
One of the things that Mo Nunn looked for in a replacement for Tony Kanaan is someone that had a good record at Portland and Cleveland.
Brad, we have 17 minutes left on P1 is 57.8.
And Brian Herta has had success here not only in Champ Cars but also in Indy Lights. He's just shown that Mo Nunn picked the right person to come here to get the most out of this car.
He mentioned the time, 57.82, and he did that in just nine laps, so there's still plenty of time. You heard it, 17 minutes left to go in this qualifying session, but an enormous jump for Brian Herta. Here is Oriel Servia. Prior to that lap by Herta, Servia had been the quickest. He is currently 10th quick. He was 9th until Servia grabbed the pole away, and Oriel is sitting there at 27.82. Well, not a good lap last time around, but 130.145 miles an hour overall, his fastest time thus far. Jan?
Brian Herta is on pit road. Morris Nunn leans in to have a chat with him, telling the crew what he wants to change. At the back, they're adding some fuel. That's what they do after each run. They only want just enough fuel to do whatever number of laps they need to. You obviously do not want to carry any more weight than absolutely necessary. This track is all about engineering, shock absorbers, springs, those decisions being made to see if Ryan hurt him and then get him going even quicker. So far, just the first set of tires have been used.
And so far, this driver, Max Pappas, has not been able to put down the kind of time and speed that he would want here. He's 14th quick.
Back way up.
Just crossing the line. And you heard the instruction, back way up, which of course means to get
you're in a good spot.
Way back from anybody that could possibly interfere with his next lap. Now he's getting the word from the pits. Let's go ahead and do a run.
He's just trying to find the right space in traffic. He wants to get heat built up in the tires, get psyched up as he comes through this back section of the course so that as he comes down the straightaway that leads into the pits, he can get a launch out of the chicane and start the lap. Preferably, you don't want anybody in front of you. You don't want anyone behind you. You just want to get into the zone here and just get the most that you can out of yourself, the tires, and the chassis.
The clock for Max Pappas is going to start right here. Line is right in that area, right under the start-finish line stand. So Pappas is hopefully on something that will substantially improve his time. Patrick Carpentier has been struggling. He runs in 19th quick right now. We'll keep an eye on Pappas. There's Carpentier.
A lot of the drivers have said that Max has been driving extremely aggressively, even on the warm-up lap, right from the first session, almost to a concern of some of the other drivers. We've seen little races break out all through practice and yesterday's qualifying, where a group of two or three guys really get into it as though it's the last few laps of the last race of the year.
Remember, Carpentier is qualifying here under a bit of a cloud. He was fined $10,000 last week for not moving over at the end of the race and allowing the leaders to come through cleanly.
But Patrick was hoping that was Canadian, Paul, so we're figuring about $6,800 U.S. on that fine.
Was Steve in the booth somewhere?
Brian Herta, the provisional pole sitter at the moment, Serbia. Serbia is still 10th quick, and Max Pappas is third quick out of this group, but that puts him 14th quick overall.
And you told him, you could hear him say that he was out of fuel and he needed to come in. He'll get another shot here at the end.
So Herta with a provisional pole for the moment, but Christian Fittipaldi is getting ready to have a shot at it. And of course, we're still waiting for first group qualifying. Well, welcome back to actually the background of the Burke Lakefront Airport, where qualifying in Group 1 continues. That was the car of this man, Tarso Marquez, who lost it down on the east end of the track and into the barriers. Here is the situation.
Comes through 7 into 8, gets a little wide trying to turn in. It's a decreasing radius corner, a little bit off camera. You can see him in the background there. Slide into the tires, and there's a big bump right at the apex. One of the few places on the track to get into the wall, and Tarso found the fence.
And he will not only serve out the problem of being a spectator for the remaining almost 3 minutes in this session, but he will serve an 8-minute penalty next time he has an opportunity to go qualify. Christian Fittipaldi is the only one who has made a substantive increase in the past few moments. He just turned a lap at 130.188 miles an hour, and that is good enough to put him in the top 10 at 10th quick.
And over the last day and a half, you watch Christian's car, Michael Andretti's car. There's one other car, Roberto Moreno's car, that's been able to handle the bumps at the Burke Lakefront Airport very, very well. It's been to the liking of Andretti, the liking of Moreno, because you've got to run the car soft in order to get it through the bumps. But Christian, I think, is having a problem finding the balance between having a car that transitions quickly, has high-speed grip, and still rides the bumps well.
Carpentier with his teammate Tagliani right behind him. Carpentier just had a quick spin that put him in that position.
And Paul, just moments ago, we'd heard Carpentier on the radio indicate that he had zero clutch. And I see him flash by us here crossing the line, so he's still out there running now into turn one.
You're riding on the nose of Max Pappas' car. He just jumped up to fifth quick. So finally, he has begun to find the speed he has been searching so desperately for. At the same time, Brian Herta returned to the course and upped the speed for the provisional pole position up to 131.463 miles an hour.
He's currently 0.3 of a second underneath Dario's provisional pole yesterday. And as we watch Max Pappas, you can see how aggressive they're getting in the final moments here, as Max not only clipped the cone on the inside, but he also hit the tires marking the inside apex of that corner.
Mark Blundell just went to 13th quick at 130.1 miles an hour. And Fittipaldi on his second quick lap at fourth quick, 130.652. Well, that information actually is probably just getting a little bit old. He's six quick, Mappas is. Well, Pappas is. But here is Herta.
You can see Brian backed off a little bit for Max Pappas, trying to give himself a little bit of breathing room. He's going to get one more lap after this to see if he can lower his time to give something for the last group to shoot at.
Clock for this half of the session is now counting within the final minute. Here's Christian, currently fourth quick. The straight that leads to the pit entrance, then a quick right, a left, and they're on the pit straight and crossing the line.
Lap, lap.
And as Fittipaldi crosses the line, there is no improvement in his time or speed, so he will sit fourth quick, at least for the moment. Here comes Pappas. And Pappas is unable to improve on his time or speed. He still sits sixth quick. Checkered flag comes out at the start-finish line. The first group qualifying now complete, one to go. As cutting the fuel very, very short, Carpentier pulls off the right side of the course. Servia, Oriol Servia does it again. He jumps up once again, this time second quick. Servia at 131.129 miles an hour. Right now, the front row in qualifying all comes out of the first group.
Max has put a very good lap together. He's right on line, used up every inch of road. He's been very smooth. We'll see if he's rewarded with a quicker time.
While we watch Max, who jumps up six quick. He does improve the time, but stays six. But Christian Fittipaldi goes third quick.
Great job, Max.
So out of this group, the top three are also the top three overall in qualifying. Herta, Servia, Fittipaldi, 1, 2, 3 in qualifying. Then the provisional pole sitter coming into today. That's Dario Franchitti, Michael Andretti, and then Max Pappas, who just turned that time out of this group. So that's the first group of qualifying now complete. The theoretically faster guys are out next, and we should see some more than interesting action. If yesterday's qualifying or this morning's practice is any kind of example, it should be cool. Welcome back to the Burke Lakefront Airport as we prepare for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. This is qualifying. This is still provisional, but look at those top three names. They all came out of the first group, and that's a little extraordinary.
When's the last time we saw Mercedes on the provisional pole? I can't remember. We've got a Mercedes, Toyota, Ford, and Honda. But wait for the second group because everything's going to change.
But currently it is Brian Herta who holds the pole. He's with Jan.
Yes, and there's some big smiles down here at Monon Racing. It looks like, Brian, you're getting a comfort factor now in this new car.
Well, I mean, the comfort factor was fine right from the get-go. These guys did a good job getting me comfortable in the car, but just, you know, it was two different drivers, and they were used to working with Tony, and, you know, he drives his car a lot different than I do, and, you know, without getting a test, unfortunately, last weekend ended up being our test day, and we had to do it in front of everybody, but luckily we learned some lessons that have definitely helped out here. I mean, I think there's still more to go, and we can still improve the car, but, you know, we've made a big jump from last weekend to now.
The fast group is next. Where do you think you might end up?
I don't know. I really don't. The track seems to be getting a little better as it goes on. Before the session, we thought 57.5, 57.6 might be what it takes. Now I think it might be a little quicker, maybe a 4 or a 3. So, you know, we'll see. If I can hang on the top 8 or so, I'd be real happy. But I just don't really know how much faster these guys are going to go yet.
All right, thanks, Brian. And by the way, he's at exactly 57.6. Gary?
Well, let's check in with Dario Franchitti, the provisional pole sitter. Right now, at the moment, you've got Brian Herta, Mercedes-Benz. You've got the Toyota with Servia. You've got the Cosworth. That puts you and the Honda in the number 4 spot. Now, does that surprise you at all?
Not really. The track's improving all the time. You know, this morning we went out there and we're almost as quick as qualifying with old tires on, so the track is getting faster. I would expect the pole time to be a bit faster than Brian's, although I think Brian's done a good job today. But it's, you know, it's difficult to get a clean lap here, to get the car working right over the bumps, to get that sometimes that lucky break over the bumps to make it all work. And you know, usually it comes down, I think, to the last lap of qualifying. The last lap of the fast group is generally where it's at.
Well, that's the way we started the show. We had your quote from yesterday saying that. We're about to find out. Maybe you'll be the guy.
I hope so, and happy belated birthday for yesterday.
Well, thank you very much. That's Dario Franchitti, Paul.
Yeah, and that's Gary Gerald, who is, call what, 6-0? Don't forget, we'll have coverage on ABC Sports of the Marconi Grand. Don't forget the coverage of Major League Soccer. Kobe Jones is one of the midfielders, along with Clint Mathis, for the Los Angeles Galaxy. They'll take on the Dallas Burn at the Cotton Bowl. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of Go Network, go.com. Well, welcome back to the shores of Lake Erie. Group 2 qualifying. Final qualifying session has just gotten underway. Most of the cars still looking for that first fast lap. But we'll see now whether or not Dario Franchitti can, in fact, defend his provisional pole. He has not yet been able to eclipse the time of Brian Herta, who sits on the provisional pole at 131.463 miles an hour.
And they're just now getting under the sub-60-second times. We should see this lap. And they start moving up the list here. Dario's got some slower traffic ahead. Everyone's trying to find a space to run in.
Shukar Kildafaran, the winner at Portland a week ago. The X indicating, of course, that this is his theoretical backup car, though the primary car, the backup car, they're really identical machines. In fact, there's a whole crew that does nothing but make changes to the other car.
And DeFerrin's teammate Castroneves on that lap, quick in disqualifying time from yesterday by a couple tenths of a mile an hour, is now in sixth place.
There's Eliel Castroneves. Scored his first victory, a very emotional win at Detroit this year. And for a while, looked like he might be the guy a week ago at Portland.
Team Penske's got so much momentum now, having won the last three or four races. They've been on the pole. They've been consistently quick. And these cars look very darty around this course, but they are very, very fast. I think they just have to hit the tires at the exact right time to get the most grip out of them. And we've seen DeFerrin off a few times already this weekend. And on that lap, he pops up to third quick at 131.090 miles per hour.
So Castroneves moving forward. Still Herta and Servia are the front row as we watch Cristiano D'Amata.
And Cristiano was quickest this morning in the practice session at 130.427 miles per hour.
The last lap was an improvement for D'Amata, but it took him only to 12th quick. While at the same time, Montoya just jumped up fourth quick, his Toyota-powered machine, Montoya at 131.063. But you would think that we're going to see some response now from this man, Dario Franchitti. Indeed, he responds. Goes to second quick behind Herta, 131.190.
And remember, for both Montoya and Vasser, it's a whole new ballgame coming into this afternoon's qualifying session. As Jan said, they've put on the extended nose cone with the extended wheelbase. It's going to change how the car feels and how it responds.
Castroneves jumps up to second quick, 131.347. But for
Paul Tracy,
there's a bit of a problem. Stopped dead on the course. He is
back wheel, right on the straightaway.
You can hear him there say it just locked up the rear wheels going down the straightaway.
Parker, I saw him. I was watching him down the back straightaway, and suddenly there was a large puff of smoke, and at first I didn't know if it was engine-related, but it clearly looked like it was tire smoke, and he just continued in a straight line and pulled it to a stop.
And it sounds like he had either a gearbox or a terminal engine problem, but if he couldn't get the clutch in to get it to roll, it sounds like it's something in the transmission driveline.
Well, his teammate, Dario Franchitti's laid down a couple of good laps, but not nearly as good as this man. Michael Andretti now takes the provisional pole away from Brian Herta at 131.682 miles an hour. On board with Montoya, currently sixth quick. Jan Beacon.
We're talking about Juan Montoya and that new aerodynamic and weight distribution change that he's had. But Parker, it turns out that Jimmy Vasser has chosen not to make the change. So it's only one half of the Ganassi team that's made the big change here prior to qualifying.
And Montoya's been very unhappy with his car all weekend long. So I think at this point, Montoya just wants any sort of change, hoping for some sort of improvement. We saw him when we first came on board this past lap. He was backed off, but now he's making a charge once again.
Cristiano Damana just moved to 10th quick. Jimmy Vassar came up to 16th. Montoya remains at 7th quick overall with Andretti, the provisional pole. Paul Tracy, he's way, way out on one of the runways at the end of the straightaway that runs parallel to the lakefront. Trying to figure out how to get that car going once again. Welcome back to the Burke Lakefront Airport. Qualifying continues. They are preparing Paul Tracy's backup car over in the pit area. The question is going to be, is how is Paul Tracy going to get from this position well, well out on the runways all the way back to the pits? He's going to have to, he literally is going to have to walk across two sections of active race course if he can do that, unless he can get a ride that would run way around the outside barrier of this track. Or, of course, if that car is capable of restarting, which, Parker, there was some indication that we don't think it is.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Otherwise, Paul would have stayed in the car. He would have waited for a flat tow to get back to the pits. And I can tell you is that inside Paul Tracy's head right now, he can see that clock ticking down. He knows he's losing time. I'm sure he's arguing with these guys to get him back to the pit lane.
A season of incredibly bad luck thus far for Paul Tracy. Gary?
Barry Green, the owner of the team, is talking with Dennis Swan, who is the pit steward down here. And Dennis just told Barry a moment ago, Paul started across the track. They pulled him back. They said, if we can get an emergency vehicle over there, if for some reason the session goes red, we will get him back. Otherwise, he's just going to be out of luck, stuck on the far side over by the lake. The backup car has been pulled here. Barry talks with Tony Sicali, one of the engineers on the team. But you're right, this run of bad luck. What a dark cloud seems to be following Paul Tracy around all of a sudden.
Well, no red flag. The qualifying continues. And in the qualifying, Cristiano Damana goes to second quick behind Michael Andretti. So it's Andretti, Damana, second row currently, Herta and Dario Franchitti. This was Guzman just a few moments ago.
On board, coming onto the quick chicane, onto the pit straight. Up to sixth gear here, 175 miles an hour, braking hard for turn one. Whoa! Locks up the rear brakes, just a quick half spin, keeps the engine running. Gets it back into first gear, takes off. One of the advantages to running in the wide open spaces of an airport circuit.
And so for Mauricio Guzman, they make a slight change to the shocks, the springs, the front of the car. And Michael Andretti is back out. His last lap was not good enough to push his current pole speed any higher than the existing 131.682 miles an hour. Jan Bikas.
Juan Montoya has been on pit road, and they made some changes on his car, all ride height related. I couldn't tell what direction they went on the front, but they definitely raised the rear of the car. I would assume maybe that means they lowered the front, trying to get a little more weight up there, since weight transfer is something they've changed for this session. We'll see if it helps them.
A little further update on Paul Tracy. There was an emergency vehicle, though not one of the regular cart emergency vehicles, was on site. It's left the scene. We assume Paul is with it. I still haven't figured out the route it would have to take to come around to the pits. Gary?
Yeah, Paul, that's exactly the case. And Dennis Swan was just confirming that with Barry Green. And he said what they're trying to do is get him around the outside of the circuit without interrupting the qualifying session. There's still going to come a point down there, however, where it seems to me, to get onto the pit access road, he's going to have to cross a hot racetrack. I don't know if he can do that. But at least he's making some progress toward this area.
Well, as we watch him, Gary, it looks like they're trying to work their way way out on the east end. And theoretically, they could come down actually behind the grandstand and dump him off. Of course, he's probably not carrying his credentials, so he couldn't get through the gate. But other than that...
Well, I think that is the plan. No man's land behind the fence there. There is a grass strip, and we're told that it is wide enough that a vehicle could get down through there, and that's where they're trying to get Paul and get him back here to the backup car, which is now they're just beginning to fire and warm the engine of the backup car.
And, you know, I said that a little tongue-in-cheek, but I do remember a race where Jimmy Kite appeared so young, despite the fact he was in a driver's suit, they wouldn't let him back through the gate.
Montoya on a quick lap here. I've been watching this. He's been going very, very well, using up all the track. Doesn't improve on his time, however. With this longer wheelbase that he's using, the car's going to have better stability over the bumps. It's going to transition a little slower through these quick right-left-hand, left-right-hand combinations. As Jan said, that's why they raise the back of the car, try to put some more of the aerodynamic force towards the front of the car, get it to transition a little quicker.
Kenny Breck, of course, he leads the rookie fight. On Friday, he was third quick overall qualifying. Best he can manage right now is 14th quick. Back to Montoya. No change in this qualifying order the past few minutes.
And it looks like he's backed out of it here, Paul. So he heads down the pit lane, yep.
Montoya will be pit bound. We're still looking for the appearance of Paul Tracy somewhere on the pit road. What about Cristiano D'Amato? He's currently second quick, Jan.
Yes, that's right. He just left pit road.
Plenty of time.
As you can hear, there's plenty of time left, and the changes that they have made for Cristiano is they added front wing. It looks like two turns of front wing, and they mess with the tire pressures as well. Montoya rolls in behind me, and his crew goes to work, so maybe he didn't like that last change.
And it wasn't something that allowed any substantive improvement for him. And Paul Tracy now has been transferred over to a golf cart, and they're going to try and run him down behind the pits and get him over to the pit gate, then to his pit, then to his backup car. With all of this, Michael Andretti still holds the provisional pole in qualifying. Kart FedEx Series is qualifying for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. That's Cristiano D'Amato, currently second quick, and he has not been able to improve any on his speed at 131.664 miles an hour.
Now keep in mind, during this segment of qualifying, they've already put in a quick lap on their first set of tires. They go back out, take two or three more runs, trying to make the final adjustments prior to putting on that last set of tires. Then in the final moments of qualifying, they dig deep and get everything they can out of those tires and themselves.
No other changes since we've left you. Jill DeFerrin, heading for the pits, is sitting sixth quick right now. We'll keep watching D'Amato.
I spoke to Cristiano after this morning's practice. He felt comfortable that he had what he needed to try to go for the pole this afternoon. He and his engineer, Ian Watt, just trying to figure out how to get the car to ride over the bumps a little better without losing its transitional quickness through the chicane and through some of the corners in the back section.
Roberto Moreno goes to ninth quick. That's a good improvement for him at 130.880 miles an hour. Jimmy Vassar is sitting 10th quick, and there is Adrian Fernandez, who is now 13th quick. He, of course, is the teammate at Patrick Racing to Roberto Moreno.
And the cars that have looked so good over the bumps all weekend long have been Fernandez and Moreno, those pair of teammates. Here you can see Moreno trailing, as well as Christian Fittipaldi and Michael Andretti. It's been difficult to tell when they've been on a quick lap because the cars go over the bumps so well. With the remainder of the competitors, the cars always look very darty and very nervous.
And as we watch Fernandez, Paul Tracy has just sprinted literally through the crowd in front of the booth here and has arrived at the Team Green pit. There he is. He climbs into his car. Moreno, by the way, just upped his position to ninth quick with 131 flat. Elio Castroneves, Jan, he may have a problem.
Yes, in fact, I believe that they are looking very carefully at the back of the car, Paul, some sort of vibration. Now, of course, on a course like this, you would want to be very careful that you didn't have a gearbox-related problem because of these bumps can really be tough on the drivetrain. So the crew has been searching every drivetrain piece that they can, looking at the engine, the suspension, and so far they're not sure what it is. They're going to throw a new set of tires on here and see if maybe that's the problem.
Well, Parker, here in the past, constant velocity joints, half shafts, gearboxes, and wheel bearings have all been an issue.
Remember, we've only been on a few street courses and one permanent road course this year, and we've seen gearbox failures, CV failures, and this place is as bumpy as it gets. I would expect that it may not become an issue today in qualifying, but certainly it will be for tomorrow's race. And keep in mind, Jan said they're changing tires. Sometimes it's simple as throwing a wheel weight or the tires rotated a little bit on the rim, and that's all it takes to fix that problem is putting a new set of tires on the car.
Well, after quite an odyssey, Gary Gerald, Paul Tracy is back in the cockpit.
Yeah, Paul, I think maybe there's one thing we haven't noted is the fact that as soon as this backup car came out here on the pit lane into this box and Tracy got here, all times recorded in the other car are now gone. You have to disqualify that car to put this one into play. Barry Green says, I know it's a gamble, but we really don't have that much to lose. They were well down, at least mid-pack at best, I don't have the latest listings on his position, but certainly there's going to be a lot of pressure on this man's shoulders right now because he has not turned a lap in this car this weekend.
Now, down at 16th, of course, that still shows on the board until they actually withdraw that car, which they automatically do, of course, as the car rolls out. Jan?
Gilles Deferrin has rolled out on the track on his second set of tires, and he made a camber adjustment. That is the angle in which the tire sits on the road. Roger Penske watching and hoping that a camber and a new set of tires for Gilles Deferrin is going to be what it takes.
So as you can see, upper left corner, there have been no changes in the top 10 in the past few minutes. And again, those gold arrowheads, they show you those who are in the current group that is attempting to qualify at this time. We are in the second final group qualifying for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. Roger Penske watching his two drivers, Helio Castroneves and Gilles Deferrin. They currently sit fifth and sixth on this provisional grid. Andretti in his fourth, he's at the top. Qualifying continues for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. We're in the final 6 minutes of qualifying. Michael Andretti still has the pole, no major changes with the exception of this man, Paul Tracy, who has climbed into the backup car, taken the car out, and so that erased all the times that he had with the primary car. Thus far, he has not managed to do anything except sit in 25th qualifying position.
Well, we'll see a big improvement for Paul over the next two laps. You could hear the calm voice of his engineer, Tony Sicali, saying, hey, you've got 7 more minutes. Very difficult situation mentally for Paul to be stranded on the course, trying to get back. It's difficult to fine-tune these cars for this bumpy circuit, then to be placed in the backup car. But, I mean, I know Paul Tracy. Sometimes none of that matters. He knows he's got 7 minutes to get it done. We'll see a substantial improvement from him before the session is over.
Michael Andretti, his Ford-powered car, still has the provisional pole. The Toyota-powered machine of Cristiano D'Amata is currently slated to start on the outside of the front row. Roberto Moreno just moved up to 7th quick. Paul Tracy has yet to improve a position that gets him, well, now finally he does. As he crosses the line, he does improve it, but not by much. 17th quick at 129.525 miles an hour.
Give him another lap, he'll keep coming up, and we're starting to see people come out on sticker tires. Over the next few laps, things will change.
And Mauricio Guzman just grabbed the pole at 131.7. Now Montoya's beginning to bring it up to speed. Currently, he sits 10th quick.
Mauricio was 4th quickest this morning. It was no fluke. The PacWest team has really got these cars hooked up. Both he and his teammate Blundell have been riding the bumps very well.
Oh, well, that pole was short live. Roberto Moreno now has the pole. Remember, he finished 2nd a week ago at Portland, and everybody says that he's overdue for a pole and a win.
I talked to Roberto's engineer, Ed Nethman, this morning after the session, and he thought they had some tweaks left for Roberto, and they obviously found some more out of this car.
A little over 4.5 minutes to go in qualifying. Adrian Fernandez goes to 7th quick at 131.3. Andretti is out there, as is D'Amata. They both crossed the line, but they have not improved their speeds. Montoya, though, just jumped up to 5th quick at 131.623.
Watch now, Paul. Every time these cars cross the line, as we wind down in qualifying, we're going to see guys not only go for the pole, but start taking each other from the pole with every successive lap.
And try this out. Paul Tracy grabs the pole. Paul Tracy. No, maybe not. We're going to have to check this. We've had some problems getting direct information out of timing and scoring, and it's saying that the speed is 369 miles an hour.
That's fast.
Man, that guy is awesome. So we will check that one for
you. That sucker's quick. That's putting the power down and going down the straights really fast.
Listen, I'm a fan. I believe he can do it. Moreno gets himself in trouble. While we wait for this clarification, and they do pull Paul Tracy's name off the top of the list, the man who is sitting now, it appears, silenced on the racetrack, Roberto Moreno, currently has the pole. But he might have needed these extra laps to continue to hold on to the pole. They have flown the red flag, stopping all qualifying because of where Roberto Moreno sits. Gary Gerald
Paul, I think we can maybe clarify what happened on Paul Tracy. We had a radio conversation that he went off the race course on the backstretch and apparently got through a shortcut. The last lap was disallowed, but maybe when it came through, it triggered that wild time that caught your and our attention.
I'm telling you what, a 300-mile-an-hour shortcut, I want to know where that one is. I'm going to use that. There's the actual. He's at 129 and sitting inside of the ninth row. Barry Green is car owner. Boy, they have not had a good year. And yet, there are a lot of us, me included, that think that by the end of the year, you're going to see Tracy right there in the middle of the fight. Moreno currently has the pole. Guzman will start on the outside of the front row, but there is still about 2.5 minutes to go. Welcome back. Qualifying, the final minutes. About a minute and 51 seconds showing on the unofficial clock for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. Moreno, the pole sitter. Guzman, second quick. Moreno, of course, off course, stop. And now, in these next few minutes, we will see how quickly they can come to speed and what they will be able to do. The sun shines down. There's no issue over the temperature changing on the circuit or anything. Now it just pedal to the metal and flat out.
And the first guys out of the pits might be able to get 2 time laps in, but these guys I don't think will make it. So the strategy here is you back completely off the throttle, you pull offline, you let everybody get away from you, take a big breath and try to get the tires up to temp in just a couple of corners, take a flying run through the chicane and try to get that last lap in.
The other thing too is they all, since they came out of the pits together, it's fairly crowded. Trying to get some clear space to make that run is going to be difficult.
And that's a bigger problem than the time remaining, because you've got to have some clear space here so you don't get held up. You can get focused and not distracted by anyone in front of you or, more importantly, anyone behind you.
Jill DeFerrin, he's got clear track ahead of him. He's first guy in line. Clock now beginning to count into the final 30 seconds of this qualifying.
And DeFerrin's done so well here. So many times. I don't think that'll hurt him, though, dropping that right rear wheel off. He's got the biggest advantage of the group, having clear track in front of him. You can see he's pushing extremely hard here.
Jan Bikas.
Moreno has posted the best time he has. He's out of the car. He now is going to watch the rest of this on the monitor.
And probably got fingers and everything else crossed to make sure that he is not eclipsed. His 132.011. Guzman crosses the line. He can't eclipse that time. Moreno still has the pole. This man may be able to do it. DeFerrin. As the checkered flag comes out. Checkered flag comes out to Jill DeFerrin. He does not take the pull, but he does go to second quick. Now the line behind him. Here comes D'Amata. Cristiano D'Amata does not improve on the time. No changes here. No changes yet. Moreno still has the pull. Will he hold on? Castroneves could snatch it. Nope, he can't do it. Tenth quick. Jimmy Vassar crosses, no change. Here's one guy that could. Montoya charges for the line. Six quick right now, and he does not improve on that. Only one car left on the course that'll see the flag, and it's Guzman. He's certainly capable. And he slows down. What a remarkable occurrence. Roberto Moreno has taken the pole, his first career pole. He's tried it for 70 different races. Last week for second, they were trying to throw him in the air. I wonder what they're going to do for him for taking the pole for the Marconi Grand Prix of Cleveland. We'll be back to talk to him in just a minute. Well, the guys were a little more disciplined in that final session than we expected. Very few off-course runs, but with Ford Power, Roberto Moreno has taken the pole. The Honda of Jill DeFerrin is second, and the Mercedes of Mauricio Guzman third quick. Jan Bikas.
And Roberto is trying to contain his emotions, but he's hugged every single crew member. Your first pole position. Congratulations. Did you really think you had a shot at it when you looked at that car this morning?
Sure. This morning, we tried to finish a lap, and I got blocked by Mauricio. And that lap was really fast. We're about 6/10 of a second quicker than anything we've done. Unfortunately, we could not show it anybody, but we knew it was good. We tried a couple other things like I always like to do with Ed. It didn't really work on the first set of tire, but I saw some potential on a different way. So we changed, went out again with the older set of tire, was faster. I said, just put a new set of tire and put a bit more pressure. And off we went. Great day for the VCM guys. I don't know what to say.
You come here as the points leader. Now you've got the pole. Is the next thing a win?
Well, we've been knocking on the door all the time. I just want to thank you, everybody that supported me to get here. Sorry, I can't talk.
No apologies necessary. Gary?
None whatsoever. Gilles DeFerrin knows what it's like to get a pole, and now you just barely miss one. How tough was it on that last lap to get a front row starting position?
Yeah, very difficult, Gary, because, I mean, I simply did not do one clear lap the whole session. And obviously, it was getting to crunch time, and still hadn't posted a time that I thought it was half decent. So we lost the best out of the tires, and you know, I kind of said, okay, well, I only got that lap to do, and you know, tried really hard, and just managed just about not to make a mistake and squeeze everything out of it. But it's, you know, I mean, second is good, but you know, I had a clear run. You know, maybe would have given Moreno a bit more of a run for his money.
Sets the stage for a great battle tomorrow. Wish you well.